Hey guys, it's Adam Harvey here. Hope you're all doing really well. This video is going to be a walkthrough of an orchestral mockup that I did of a well-known piece of music called Enterprising Young Men from the 2009 Star Trek soundtrack by Michael Giacchino. It's a great piece of music. And to do this mockup, I've used exclusively audio Imperia libraries. So last year I got Areia, their string library, and I also picked up a bundle with Jaeger and Cerberus and Talos and trailer guitars and a few other things. I've had Nucleus for a while now, and I think it's a great library, great sort of all-in-one orchestral library. And recently I've added Solo as well, which is their library of orchestral, solo orchestral instruments, which sounds great. So I thought it would be a good idea to put an audio Imperia template together to mock up a well-known piece of music, and then just to do a video on kind of how I did that. So this video is going to go into some of the tips and tricks I use to arrange and orchestrate the different parts to try and get more realism from the MIDI, how I sort of manipulated the libraries to get the sound that I got. I won't go too much into mixing in this video. If you guys want to know a bit more about the mixing, I might do that in a separate video if that was something you wanted. But to be honest, there's not a ton of mixing going on. It just sounds great out of the box anyway. So I think the best way to approach this is if I just play the piece through from start to finish, and then we can go back and sort of break it down bit by bit and look at how I put it all together. So I'll just play it from the beginning and then we'll go from there. So there we have it, the mock-up of Enterprising Young Men. So I guess we will just start at the beginning once this is auto-saved. There we go. And we shall start with what's happening in the pitch percussion. So I chose to use the marimba from Nucleus, just in classic mix mode, because, you know, this is supposed to sound like a real orchestra on a scoring stage. So for some of the instruments, I've chosen the classic mix, which is a little bit more of a sort of normal mix, whereas the modern mix tends to be a little bit more hyped. And I've also used the xylophone, and they are just playing these sort of so just a simple pattern, kind of a bit of a sort of motor, really, just these broken chords. And with that, we've got the viola playing this phrase. just using Areia and the spiccato. And I've also used, I've brought the mic, you can sort of adjust the position of each instrument using this sort of pretty simple slide. So I've just brought everything slightly closer, make it a bit drier, and then I can use reverb and EQ to kind of manipulate how I want it to sound on the stage. And I've just combined that with the two clarinets from Nucleus playing staccatissimo. They're very quiet in the mix. Here we go. But they're just adding a tiny bit more weight to that viola. So together. Just kind of feel them in there slightly. So that's what's happening in the beginning. So we obviously have these high strings coming in, also spiccato. They're just playing those spiccato patches. And then we have this, the solo flute. Now, I'll show you what I've done here. This is from Audio Imperia's new solo library. Again, I brought it slightly closer in the mix. I've left the reverb on here just to give it a bit more reverb, because I've combined that with my reverbs as well. But I'll show you what I've done. So you can hear it sounds almost like it has this strange flutter tongue effect, which isn't actually in the articulation. But I'll show you how I've achieved that. It's pretty straightforward. I've just used a Cubase plugin called Chopper. And that's just creating this kind of tremolo effect. Without it, it sounds like this. So still sounds fine, but in the original I noticed there was this kind of flutter tongue, slightly overblown effect, so I've emulated that somewhat with the flute, and that's also being combined with the Glock, again from Nucleus, just a Glockenspiel. Together they sound like this. So the Glock is just adding some high-end content in there and just sort of layering nicely with the solo flute. So we carry on. So at this point, we have some more instruments joining the fold. We have some percussion, a simple tam-tam roll, and also this piatti very quietly too. And I should also mention that going through at the beginning of this are these sticks from Cerberus. So they're just the click ensemble. Alone they sound like this. They're just part of the original track, you know, they have these clicks in the original track and they just help add some sort of transient excitement, some momentum. So if we go back to where we were, here we go. So we have these rolls in the tam-tam and then the piatti hit, and then that introduces us to some stuff going on in the brass. So we start off with, actually let's just start off with the strings. So we have the low strings, the celli and the double bass coming in just playing sustained notes, root notes. Really straightforward stuff there, and they are being doubled with the tubas. It's the Jaeger two tubas, so they sound pretty good. And I've also got the Nucleus two bassoons playing at this point too. Pretty quiet in the mix again. But they're just adding that kind of reedy quality. So the low instruments together. Really basic stuff. And then layered into that is this, well, two solo horns, again from the solo library, sound great, and they're just doing this. Sound kind of a bit strange on their own, but they're just helping that leap from the lower octave to the upper octave just helps reinforce the viola pattern that's going on. And then we have this long sort of note that goes into the next section, and in context you can hear what that's kind of doing. This point we have the solo trumpet, again from solo the library, joining us. Sounds really nice. So it sort of takes over from the flute. really beautiful solo quality there, and I'll just show you how that works with the flute. That sounds really cool together. And I'll just show you, actually, to go back to the strings as well, because I'll show you talking about realism and how to get enhanced realism. So we have this spiccato in the strings. I'll just play the first violins. But I noticed that there was a kind of little flourish between each chord change. So what I've done is, you know, there's all different ways to arrange your templates. Some people like to put every articulation on a different instrument track. Some people, you know, like to just use longs and shorts or something. I tend to just layer things as and when I need them. So I'll call things, you know, violins one, violins 1B, maybe a C if I needed it. In this case, I didn't. But on the B track, I've just got this going on. Sounds a bit weird out of context. It's just the whole tone trill. But if I combine them together, it just helps add that kind of flourish, and it still sounds a little bit weird out of context. I'll show you it happens again. But in context, it sounds... just adds a little bit more realism and just something a little bit more expressive to that section. And of course, it's in the original too, which is important. So try to emulate that somewhat. We also have these beautiful Jaeger six horns entering at this point, playing this great legato line. Just really nice, like, you know, legato up to the note and back down again. Sounds great. So the brass at this point is sort of building in intensity as more and more instruments are coming in. So I'll just play the brass on its own. So you can see the low brass begins playing these sort of staccatissimo patterns. We also have the Jaeger trumpet ensemble coming in, playing the chords. They just sound really nice, help to start bringing some intensity to this section. And all together with everything else. Nice big full sound. The woodwinds throughout most of this track, to be honest, but they're really just kind of doubling and adding, you know, woodwinds in sort of modern hybrid scoring. You tend not to use that much woodwinds, but in more traditional film scoring, wanting to sound like a real orchestra on a scoring stage, you know, woodwinds add a lot of texture. Even if you don't think you can hear them, there's something that they do in the mid and upper mids, which is really important in terms of strengthening and reinforcing other instruments. So, you know, I always try and put them in, partly because obviously they must be in there somewhere, and partly because they're just adding a weight to the track that wouldn't be there otherwise. But they're mostly just doubling other instruments, as I can show you here. So not really stuff that you would hear in and of itself, but I definitely feel like you would miss it if it wasn't there. You know, it's really not something that you can sort of hear in and of itself, but there's just something in the mids that kind of just dips out a bit if you don't keep those woodwinds in. At this point as well, we also have in the percussion just snares and toms and the bass drum joining us, as well as a timpani. Timpani is just the standard one from Nucleus. Sounds really good. Together they all sound like this. Sounds really cool. Now, the way that I've tried to sort of arrange and put these percussion in the track is like a traditional percussion section in an orchestra, which traditionally would be at the back of the hall, sort of, and you would hear it from the back of the hall. So they'd actually sound quite distant and not so in your face as perhaps more modern music. As a result, I've done some things to try and achieve that, and I can show you that. For example, in these toms, I'm pushing them back in the mix using this mix knob here. That's just really helping to kind of put them where I want them to be. I'm probably doing that with the snares too. I just bring them over here, actually pushing them closer, but probably adding more reverb. But generally speaking, everything sounds as if it's in a space. It's not like modern music where it might really just sort of be this kind of sort of head melting stuff right in the front of the speakers. It's a lot more subtle than that. And then with the bass drum, just really quiet. You can barely hear it. It's just adding some extra weight. And then obviously the timpani, just adding the tonal percussion element. Really nice. And that's just obviously, you know, percussion's job in sort of traditional film scoring or orchestral scoring is just to really accent key notes, to really bring some weight to specific lines. So obviously we've had pretty light percussion here, but when we get to these staccatissimo, these big chords here, we really need the percussion to drive everything forward. Into the main theme. Now the main theme is being heard predominantly on the brass, and Audio Imperia stuff just works fantastically for these kinds of melodies. I mean, the legatos on these are so great that you kind of don't have to do anything and they already sound awesome. So just perfect for this kind of music, sounds so good. Same with the horns. They sang great. And then we just have in the low brass, so in the trombones and the tubas are just sort of playing the bass, you know, the bass notes. The trombones are taking the chords. Here we are. And I'm always, I mean, I'll go into this in more detail soon, but I'm always using expression and modulation data to try and make these things sound more realistic. I think that the more that you can use them, you don't necessarily have to use them aggressively, but just gently shaping things so they're never static. They always sound like they're being played by players. And it's good to try and think like players too. So for example, these are brass instruments. Therefore, they're controlled by players using their breath. Breath is obviously finite. You need to take a breath before you can use more air. So we simulate that by putting small breaks in between these different chords, by thinking about, well, when would trombone players most likely take a breath? It's probably going to be here after the first instance of this sort of phrase. So if I just play this. See, that break there just really helps to kind of add a sense of realism. Yeah, because the trombonist would have to take a break there before they move forward. So I'd always be trying to think about that. How, you know, a string player or a cello player, for example, wouldn't have to do that. You know, there wouldn't have to be a break here. But brass, woodwind certainly would have to breathe at some point. And adding those things in, ironically, it's those imperfections that make the music come to life and make it sound more realistic. So try and put them in your scores. Yeah, so that's a little trick there. So basically, the trombones and the tubas are just taking the kind of the main chords. And with the brass. So that's the whole brass, and then we'll move to the strings. The strings are actually, there's no chords. The only chords that are being played are the harmony by the trombones here. So the strings are just playing the bass line and the melody, as you can see here. So what we have here is the melody being played in three octaves by the first, second violins, the violas, and the cellos. So it's a really full sound, and that's really adding to the kind of the sense of weight when this first part of the main theme comes in. Sounds really huge, and you can hear combined with the brass melody, just sounds massive. So that sounds really cool. The woodwinds are again kind of supporting. We do have these sort of runs in the flutes, which sound a bit weird by themselves, but they are in the original track and they just help to add some kind of life to these chord changes. So not the most realistic programming, but again, it's all about priorities. You know, you're not really hearing these woodwinds, you're just sensing them in the mix at this point. So haven't worried too much about getting it perfect, but you can just hear them poking through in the full section. Really, really gentle there, but that's what the woodwinds are doing, just kind of supporting. And then in the percussion, again, it's not a percussion driven piece, so we just have quite light timpanis just picking out some of the root notes and the toms just supporting them. It's all pretty straightforward stuff. So if we just carry on here. Obviously at this point the strings create a counter melody. So a very common technique in orchestral music, strings just soar, you know, and there's no better sound than strings just soaring over the top of an orchestra. So having that counter melody soar over the top of the main melody just adds a real sense that this piece is progressing forward and that, you know, the theme is kind of developing and becoming more complex. So it just sounds great. So not much to note here, just that the trombones are changing from the sustained chords to the staccatissimo chords here. Just sound really nice and help to add some kind of rhythmic interest at this point at the end of this first statement of the theme. So I just play the brass in the context. We have the melody in the French horns. Trumpets are bowing out temporarily and then coming back in with these nice staccatissimo chords that really just end this first phrase. Sounds really cool. The only thing of note really in the strings is, again, I've used these B strings, the violin 2B, and the violas are taking this in nice string run. Sounds really nice, just gentle in the background. They're being supported by the flutes and the oboes as well. But that's really all that's going on in the strings that's any different. The horn is just being doubled by the violin an octave up. Nice big full sound, and then it breaks it into a string chord there as well, which I'll show you. So then descending string run there. Not much to say about the woodwinds. They're really just doubling what's going on in the brass and the strings. So let me get to this section here. So at this point, we're bringing a bit more rhythmic interest into the snares. So they're just sort of, we're adding a bit more complexity and subdividing some of the beats and just adding some flams and things and some rolls, just making them sound more interesting. We also have a very brief appearance by the Nucleus ride cymbal from their drum kit. Literally just pops in for one ride cymbal. It's in the original, sounds good, just adds a bit of, you know, a nice rhythmic interest there. And that's all that's really going on there. We have this in, well, actually this is worth mentioning, I've changed at this point from the using the cello and the bass separately to just using a patch that's them in octaves, because at this point they're really just doubling each other an octave apart, so kind of just makes sense to use this patch. And I'll show you what this sounds like. And going back to what we were talking about earlier, when we were talking about doubling and using different articulations to create more realistic lines, we have this going on. The sound's completely weird by itself, but if you listen to the original line, we're switching between short and legato notes, as you can hear here. When we were moving to the legato here, you can see the key switch changing. When we moved to this legato, I just felt something was missing. There was an attack missing. So all I did was just put that note in here, but it's being played. You can't hear it actually because I'm on. So just using a short patch. But you can just hear if I play without that. Sounds like something's dropping out a little, and if I include that, just helps add a bit more attack, which I think was needed at this point. That's just being doubled in the tubas and the trombones. Really just making use of their great, you know, lower range there. So really nice militaristic sound with these snares and things as well. We move into this section here, and what we've done here is I've got what's called Jaeger trumpets muted. So you can hear they sound a bit like they're muted, and I've just achieved that by using an EQ and just cutting away most, well, pretty much all the low end and quite a lot of the middle and high mids as well, just leaving the sort of the highs really. So if I just play without that EQ. It's that, I think it's a muted trumpet in the original track, so that's just what I decided to do. So sounds really nice. And then we just have a kind of counter melody or additional melody being provided by the horns, the two flutes patch from Nucleus, and these strings as well, which I think are playing. So I think they're just playing moccato and short patches. Yeah, moccato patches, just to give them that slightly greater attack. But together, they sound. All sounds pretty nice. So just carry on. Had that nice little section there, and what I've done is used the solo horns staccatissimo, as you can see here, because there's a really distinctive sound to horns playing a chord, you know, split chord, and I wanted to capture that sound and not just use the ensemble patch. So really nice sound, and that just combines with the strings. Sounds really cool. And there's actually no woodwind at that point apart from the bassoons, because I think, you know, the brass and the strings more than cover that, and it's actually quite a distinctive texture without the woodwind at that point. So that little melody is being played by, at this point, it's tremolo strings. So if I just play them in isolation. And they're being combined with the trumpet ensemble and the horns, quite a full sound. And all also, just to show you what I'm doing here, again, talking about creating greater realism. So I'm always, as I said, using modulation and expression. And I find it particularly important at the end of phrases, because quite often when a player is coming to the end of a phrase, they're going to kind of back off. They're gonna sort of recede into the background, if you like. And you can't always get that from just the release samples in a library, but you can kind of emulate it by using the release samples in combination with the expression data. So let me just show you what this sounds like soloed. See, we're really backing down on that modulation, and we're also bringing the volume down with the expression as well. If I was just to play, so if I play this as it is, if I didn't have that going on and just kept everything flat, it would sound fine, but just kind of doesn't really, well, actually, if I do it in context with the mix, you might hear it better. Doesn't really have the same effect, whereas if we drop everything off, it really has this lovely feeling of moving into a new section. And then we have this much more expressive section here, which is being provided by these lovely legato strings. Sound amazing. Again, using the modulation and expression data to just craft these releases a bit more realistically. And there's also a beautiful sound in flute here. I could probably actually make that sound a bit more realistic by... So let's just do this in real time. It's probably just going to sound a little bit more natural. That's quite nice. Okay, and at this point then we just introduced the solo oboe. This is actually the solo oboe from Nucleus, not from solo, because that one sounds great too, so I just decided to use that. Bringing the solo oboe in just adds some more body to the flute, you know, just kind of reinforces the flute, adds a slightly more nasally quality, which really works to help it cut through. So you can hear the solo flute alone and then the flute and oboe combined. And they're being doubled with this marimba as well. This marimba just sounds like Star Trek to me. You know, it's just got that classic old school sci-fi sound. Just great combined with the woodwinds. Just sounds really cool. We just have this little spiccato strings. It's helping provide a little kind of motor at this section, some rhythm. So now we have the build up into the climax, you know, the whole piece is coming to the end now. So if we just maybe go through the percussion, not a lot to say, but we've just got some nice rolls going on here, courtesy of the Jaeger bass drum and I believe the tam tam too. So Sounds really nice. You've got that tam-tam that just helps us move into that next section. I think we might also have something on the timpani too. Yep. Just really nice, full way to move us into that next section. We have these tremolo, ascending tremolo strings. If I just solo the strings. And then what happens is they break into these tremolo chords. So you'll hear them now. And again, I'm just using these B patches that I've created just to split the chords, almost like the Divisi strings now. So you've got a full chord going on. So if I show you the MIDI. Sounds really nice. And then the violas are just playing the melody that's actually mostly in the brass. So we'll move to the brass because that's really the focus of this climax section, at least at this stage. So we have the melody on the horns. We've actually got them on the six horns patch from Jaeger here, doubled with the solo horn. The reason I used the solo horn at this point was because the horns are actually quite quiet at this point. Even though this is the climax, it actually sort of starts quite gently. And I wanted a bit more expressivity from the horn, so I decided to layer the solo horn with the ensemble horn. So if I just play the solo horn on its own. Start again. Sounds really nice, but with the ensemble. Sounds really great. And the only thing I'm doing here is using the clarinets to play to sort of double the horns, but they sound slightly different. I'll show you now. So I'm using the key switches to change between the long and the short patch, and that might sound a bit weird by itself. Really all I'm doing is I'm using these shorts. Again, you can't really hear them. You can just feel them adding some attack to the horns. So if I just play without. And now with. So it's just adding some attack, and you kind of need that for it to cut through what else is going on. So we have those horns, and we also have a counter melody on the trumpets here. So. So together they sound like this. So just this really nice building, kind of evolving, growing, ascending sort of melody, I guess, and counter melody. Sounds really cool. And then we have in the low tubas, trombones, and the low strings, we just have this kind of bass line that's rumbling underneath. Really cool when combined with the melody. We'll just carry on with the brass here because some interesting things happen. So we get to the end of the first phrase of this climactic section. So everything really ramps up a notch for the second statement of this theme. And the way that we do that is a few different things. First of all, obviously, we use the modulation data to open up these horns. So you can hear we really increase the intensity of those horns. We also lose the solo horns at that point, which even though it sounds like we're losing something, actually that makes it sound more like an ensemble playing at higher volume. So we lose some of the clarity, but we gain some of the power from that. In the trumpets, we have the same counter melody, but now we're using a second trumpet patch so that we can play the melody in octaves. And that really helps reinforce the power of it. Sounds great. On its own, just a single patch would have sounded fine too, but you just really want that octave below to add some power. So alone. Sounds fine, but with the octave. Sounds so much more powerful. And the only other thing we do here is in the low brass, we push the trombone an octave higher, and that just really helps to, again, add, it starts bringing the trombone into its higher register, and that just adds some more power and some more excitement. So really cool. So altogether the brass sounds like this in that climactic section. Now what happens in the strings is really interesting too. So we had those tremolo chords playing. So at this point, they break out to double the brass in the melody. And that breakout into those soaring legato strings is just a surefire way to create this exciting, flowing, big, epic sound. So you can hear what happens is the strings begin by doubling the French horn melody, and then they immediately leap up to double the trumpet melody and stay there. And that leap, I mean, number one, it's something that you can only do really with strings, that kind of huge leap. And number two, it just really helps just make this last section soar. So if I just play that again. And if I play it with the horns and the trumpets, you'll really get what I mean. Just adds so much power and excitement to that end. And the flute, sorry, the woodwinds are really just doubling, you know, they're not doing anything specific by themselves. And again, I'm using these staccatissimo patches, if I just move here. And they might sound a bit weird on their own, but they're really just helping to reinforce and add some attack to these, the brass and the strings, which are really where the action's happening. So by themselves, don't sound great, but they're adding a lot of force to what else is going on. The percussion doesn't really change too much, but we do start to introduce this tom rhythm along with the snare, which just helps drive things forward. So again, the percussion's not the driving force of this piece, but they're just, you know, gently in the background to add some transient rhythm and transient excitement to what's going on in the rest of the orchestra. And I guess the final thing here is just this Glock, which is playing the trumpet melody. Again, you can hardly hear it by itself, but you can just hear it adding a tiny bit of upper end excitement and transient to that trumpet. Very subtle, but just adding something there. And that's really how we build this climax. Build to this final outro section here. And again, talking about realism, once again, I'm always using the expression and the modulation data, and particularly at points like this, because if you hear, you know, the way we sort of get the music to kind of climax into this very big outro is through things like brass swells and really dipping everything down before it comes back up. So if I just isolate the brass. You can hear we really got these nice swells going on courtesy of this modulation data. So if I just show you the horns. And same sort of thing going on in things like the trombones, so, and the tubas. Actually, the tubas drop out here. So. We just have that moment you drop out of the tubas so that when they come back in, we really get the full weight of those staccatissimo articulations at the end. But yeah, it's moments like these that really make an orchestra sound like an orchestra. These sort of big crescendos, decrescendos, these moments of kind of tension and resolve. So, you know, you really want to craft these moments. And you can hear what's going on in the strings. So same sort of thing. We're always using the modulation data just to bring back these swells and things. You know, we might have even been able to go a bit harder here, but you know, that's kind of just personal preference. Using probably as well the timpani and the drum rolls, the bass drum rolls. They're just adding, you know, those big sort of beefy percussion elements at the end. So yeah, pretty self-explanatory at the end. We just have a lot of these short notes just really just hammering out these last chords, you know, sounds very exciting, very big. We introduce right at the very end there a ride cymbal again, just because it's in the original piece. So and there we have it, that's the end of our piece. Yeah, so there's probably a few other things I should mention in terms of trying to make things sound more realistic. Another way to enhance realism in particularly sort of traditional orchestral film scoring is definitely going to be through the use of tempo track and through creating these kinds of slowdowns and speed ups, you know, that they're really going to help sell the kind of naturalness, almost as if someone's conducting this orchestra. And even though I'm not doing too many crazy time changes, I am at key points just slowing things down and speeding things up. So these little slowdowns and little pauses here before going back to the original tempo are really important just for creating excitement and contrast and dynamism in these pieces. So I would definitely recommend using the tempo track. Again, it's not something you do as much in sort of modern trailer music, hybrid music stuff, because everything is so percussion driven that you kind of want the consistency of speed. But that's not true in more traditional orchestral scoring, which relies a lot on timing to kind of create excitement and tension and build these kinds of dynamic layers. The other thing I would say is if you've got a MIDI keyboard and you're comfortable playing it, play in all these lines, you know, when you get what the line that you want, play it in by hand, because playing it naturally will make things it just naturally bring a sense of performance to it, whereas if you write everything in, you almost have to deconstruct it and kind of, you know, kind of make it sound less perfect, otherwise it's just going to sound a bit too robotic. I actually wrote all this in because I didn't have my MIDI piano at the time, so I actually ended up having to almost what I call kind of like slopify it. You know, I had to kind of write it all imperfect and then deconstruct it. And I can just show you sort of how I do things like that. So pretty simple tricks, like for example, here we've got these chords, but as you can see, every note is slightly out of time randomly. You know, they're not all played perfectly because that would sound a bit mechanical. And you can do this, you know, either by writing them in painstakingly that way. You can also use things like the quantize feature. I think it's called humanize in Logic. And that can do things like, for example, if I take this little section, you can quantize it in 16ths, which is what these are, but you can add randomize. If I maybe say I want to randomize it that much, and now you can see it's changing, but it's not perfect. Everything is randomized slightly, you know, so it's attaching to the grid, but then it's adding a random kind of slight time change, which is just helping create more realistic lines. And that's really important, particularly with things like staccatissimo sections, because if you have everything just right on the grid, it's going to sound a bit robotic, whereas you have these tiny millisecond differences between notes, that's going to sound more like real players, because as good as real players are, and they're great, that nobody's absolutely dead on at the same time. So it's just adding a sense of realism and a sense of depth by having these notes come in fractions of a millisecond even at different times. And I've done that pretty much right through this piece. You know, I've kind of tried to make everything, you know, if we go here, this might be a bad example. But yeah, for most things, I mean, I could just do it here, do a quantize, now everything's slightly off. It just adds a sense of realism. So I try not to leave too many things on the grid. As I said, because I wrote all this in, I did leave things on some things on the grid if they didn't need to be changed. But with key sections, I'm nearly always trying to add some kind of realism to things. And I keep finding examples of where I haven't added that realism, but never mind. So that's another technique that I always suggest that you use in combination with, as we mentioned previously, a lot of writing of these modulation expression data. So pretty much every track has a fair amount of it here. I don't think I'm ever not using it. And some of it has a lot as well. So yeah, I would always recommend using that stuff. It's the best way to get realistic patterns. I think we'll wrap that up here for now. As I said, if you guys want to know a bit more about the mixing, there's not that much to say about it, but I'm happy to do a video about that and go into detail a bit more about how I mix this together. But to be honest, these sound amazing out of the box, and because they're all from the same sample library or sample library company, they have a consistency, which is why I wanted to put them all together and check them all out as one unit, because they're all, to my knowledge, recorded in the same place, and there's just a consistency of program and a consistency of approach there that means that you can pretty much just take them out of the box and they're going to sound great. And I've done some EQ, but to be honest, most of that was just to emulate the original track. It wasn't because there were problems inherent in the sound. It was just that I wanted the slightly darker, more natural sound of the original track, so I needed to do some EQ to get that. And I suppose I can really briefly go through my reverb, but there's not a lot to say. I'm using a combination of algorithmic and convolution reverb. So I have the convolution quantum leap spaces. I've had this for ages. I just use it. Sounds pretty good. Got this Californian hall, and I'm using a different convolution reverb for each section, for brass, for strings, etc. And I've got the seventh heaven reverb, great reverb. And that's an algorithmic reverb that's set to the Sanders Hall setting 2.9 second, and then no pre-delay. And basically, it's a kind of trick that I learned from other people. Using a combination of convolution and algorithmic reverb produces these really interesting reverb kind of hallmarks, I guess, because I think convolution reverb, generally speaking, it's, you know, it's the sound of a real space, which is good, but there's a kind of slightly more mechanical, slightly more sterile way in which convolution reverb works, whereas algorithmic reverb, because it's mathematical, it actually has some kind of randomization built in, which means that you get reflections and sounds that are never the same twice. Combining them together, generally speaking, at least in my experience, provides the best results. And I can show you, I mean, it's pretty straightforward. All I do is in the different bus sections, so I've got everything going to buses, strings, brass, woodwinds, percussion, etc. And I'm just adding a bit of reverb as I see fit. So if I just solo these strings and play them without any reverb. Sound great, but pretty dry, especially for a piece of music like this, so just adding the reverb to taste. So there we have it. I think that goes through most of the main stuff without going into too much excruciating detail. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed that, found it useful. If you've got any comments, any questions, feel free to leave them to me, and I will be happy to answer if I can. And yeah, I hope you guys found that useful. Thanks for watching.